able to come for a few days. Her boy's sick again.
Will you be able to manage?
Spending half crowns and 5 shillings on cab fares every day this week. She won't give a hint to what she's up to.
I'm sure your mother's allowed to do as she pleases with her money.
It'll be for your sake, my dears. Mr. Verloc's been kind to me, but I'm in the way here. And if I have a place of my own, it'll be for the best.
You're no trouble, Mother.
You made the right marriage. It's been good for Stevie. He's quite enough to look after.
Will you be back for supper tonight?
Supper? Probably. Stevie. Stevie.
Stevie.
We're not very satisfied with the attitude of the police here.
Every country has its police.
What is required is something definite that might stimulate their vigilance. That is your province, is it not? The absence of repressive measures is a scandal. In spite of appearances to the contrary, we know that unrest exists.
Oh, yes, yes, it does, undoubtedly. To a dangerous degree. My reports for the last 12 months.
I've read them. I don't know why you wrote them. What is required is not words, but the bringing to light of a distinct, significant fact.
Yes, well, I'll do my best.
You're getting fat.
I'm sorry for that.
I think you'd better see Mr. Vladimir.
Mr. C'est vrai, il est gros, très gros.
Absolument, oui.
I suppose you understand French.
Yes, I did my military service there. I was in the French artillery.
Ah, yes. You got us the design of the improved breech block on their field gun. What did you get for that? 5 years?
5 years.
You were lucky. You shouldn't have been called. Why did you start selling yourself? Cherchez la femme. She got hold of the money and sold you to the police. You're not very clever, are you? How long have you been drawing tay from this embassy? Since Lord Fertenheim's time?
11 years.
You're an idle fellow. Are you an anarchist? Or a socialist?
An anarchist.
I have called you here to tell you the Secret Service is not a philanthropic organization. What we need is activity.
If you would be good enough to look up my record.
You call yourself an agent provocateur. The proper business of an agent provocateur is to provoke. You have done nothing for 3 years.
Several times I have prevented.
We don't want prevention, we want a cure. You're too English.
I am English.
Oh, you are English?
Yes. I'm a natural born British subject. My father was French, and so we...
You were born in England?
Yes.
How absurd the English are. This sentimental regard for individual liberty. So you are the famous secret agent. So valuable that you appear only as a symbol in the correspondence of my predecessor.
I have been here only twice before. Permit me to observe to you that it is not wise to call me here, especially during the day. There's a chance I might be seen. It would destroy my usefulness.
That's your affair. When you cease to be useful, you will cease to be employed. Oh, sit down, for goodness sake. The result of this English respect for liberty is that London is full of revolutionaries planning criminal acts abroad. Terrorists from my country, particularly.
Is it not easier to keep an eye on them here?
It would be easier to keep them under lock and key. You surely agree the middle classes here are stupid.
Oh, yes, yes.
To tolerate the very people who drive them out of their houses to starve in ditches.
Yes, they are.
It's vanity. What the English need is a good scare. Now is the psychological moment to set your friends to work. Report back to me with a plan.
A plan?
Yes. Why are you looking at me like that? I mean an act of violence.
You want me?
Well, I don't care who does it. I want you to organize it. You'd better think about it and get back to me when you've got a plan.
But why?
There is this conference in Milan. We want all European countries to crack down on these revolutionaries wherever they find them. Unfortunately, the conference will get nowhere because certain countries are too fond of the rights of man. We want to administer a tonic to this conference in Milan. We want you to do it, Furlock, here in London. Then perhaps our European neighbors might realize there is only one way to deal with terror.
It will cost money.
We give you money. Don't ask for any more. But in case you think you can carry on in the same ineffective manner, remember, we also give you protection. Think what the consequences would be if we were to remove that protection. If certain people were to know what kind of man you are, Verloc. If certain people were to hear about you.
For anything. That's the kind of men I want to see. Men who believe in death. But look at you. You're all cynics, pessimists.
Remember, I was in prison for 15 years. If I was a pessimist, I would have put an end to myself. All that is necessary is patience, believe me. One day, the poor and the meek of the earth will inherit all its riches. You can be sure of it. This is not a philosophy, I assure you. It is a law of nature, and we must wait for it to happen.
Wait? No. The poor must destroy their oppressors.
And who are they?
The capitalists. The rich invented capitalism because of their greed. Destroy capitalism, and you destroy those who grow fat on it.
You forget that capitalism has helped to create socialism, and socialism is the great humanitarian hope of the future. And men did not create it in their heads. History created it.
So what do we do then? We sit around and do nothing, do we? I might as well throw all these away.
I didn't say that.
It doesn't matter sitting around educating the masses. What matters is their emotional state. Are they angry or hungry enough to act?
Why do we waste our time with this nonsense? If you did not exist, Michaelis, the capitalists would create you to make their lives safer. The rich are nourishing their greed on warm blood, feeding on the quivering flesh of the poor.
Time for me to go, I think. I'm sorry to leave so early.
Probably time to break up anyway. Hope to see you next week, yeah?
Blood money. He's going to visit his patron. You know, she sent him to Marienbad for his health. First he was arrested, then they wouldn't let him take the water.
Winnie?
What are you doing here? Go to bed, Stevie. Were you listening at the door?
Yeah, you look at this.
You're looking particularly beautiful this evening, Mrs. Verloc.
I don't know what he was doing there.
He's all right, Verloc. He's a good boy.
Yes, he's an interesting case of degeneracy. Of a certain kind, medically speaking.
You think so, do you, Tom?
Haven't you read Lombroso? Look at his earlobes.
You'll see. Lombroso was a fool!
Strange contrast. Eroticism and the bourgeois marriage.
Good night, Tom.
Margaret.
My dear Annie. Well, Henry, I shall have to call you Assistant Commissioner now.
You can call me anything you please, dear lady.
Allow me to introduce Mr. Vladimir Pienskov. Vladimir has charmed us all since he was posted here. He will tell you everything about himself.
Everything and nothing.
Is he here?
He bears himself with such grace for one who has suffered so much. They could still drag him back to prison if it pleases them.
Surely not.
There was a great deal of popular feeling at the time, encouraged by the newspapers, you probably don't remember. They were trying to release some comrades. His job was to force open the door at the back of the prison van, but one of them shot a policeman instead of the horse. Michaelis didn't even know a man had died when they arrested him. He can't practice a trade. His parents are dead, and the girl he was going to marry died while he was in prison. I suppose it will embarrass Henry, the Assistant Commissioner of Police in the same room as a notorious political criminal.
Then Henry will just have to be embarrassed. He can usually look after himself.
Not in everything.
He's beginning to grow accustomed to the style in which I can afford to keep him.
Then Henry can afford to be civil to poor Mr. Mercatus.
Is that him?
But don't stare. He's still a little gauche.
Sorry.
None whatsoever.
What happens to me as an individual doesn't matter. Besides, I have the generosity of friends to thank. I must go now. Will you excuse me?
Of course.
In prison, they turn the lights out early. Can't stay awake after nine.
Managed to find him a small cottage in Kent where he may be in peace. And this is supposed to be officially a revolutionist. What nonsense.
What a dangerous one, perhaps.
I should think not, indeed.
How can such a thing be allowed to happen to an innocent man? All that time in prison, he simply thought things out for himself.
I have to take the cab on.
It's very late.
I'm sorry. I must.
Henry, were you happier in Africa?
Annie! I'll be back as soon as I can. Scotland Yard. Anything in the air?
Ah, it's all quiet. Very, very quiet.
So, I shall be able to report to the Home Secretary that we have everything under control.
Inasmuch as you can be sure with the revolutionaries.
How do we make sure?
I have a very good informer. He keeps me in touch with their movements.
When did you last see him?
I see him regularly, sir. He's very close to the centre of things.
Well, I trust you'll keep me up to date. We must develop a close working relationship.
Closer?
I'm the new boy. I need to know what's going on.
Yes, sir.
I understand the Home Secretary is very concerned about political activity.
I know our London anarchists, and there's not one of them with enough spunk. Well, there's only one. Michaelis. He's a man of a different sort.
Oh, Michaelis?
You know who I'm talking about, do you?
Fellow who's out of prison on ticket of leave.
Not for long, I hope.
Why do you say that?
He killed a policeman, sir.
I think he didn't actually condone the firing of the shot.
There was a lot of publicity when they let him out of jail. A man like Michaelis can use public attention to spread a lot of seditious ideas, don't you think, sir?
Thank you.
Mother, you've only got yourself to blame if you're not happy afterwards. What will people think of us? You're throwing yourself on charity.
No, he mustn't.
My dear, you've always been the best of daughters to me.
Don't.
Not a very good horse. Very slow.
Don't, Stevie! Whip, don't whip!
I've got to take
you're
out
too heavy! You're too heavy! Too heavy!
No!
Walk! Walk!
Side! Mr. Burnett won't be very happy when he hears about this. He won't be very happy at all, Stevie.
What do you want?
My wife and her brother will be back.
You haven't been in touch.
You said mostly by letter. If there was anything, I would let you know.
What about Michaelis? Shop at any time. Be in touch. I want Michaelis.
Special crimes.
Yes, Ethelred.
I saw Heat last time. You were rather new to the job.
I've found my feet, I think.
I have a particular concern about special crimes.
I don't think, sir, there's any cause for concern.
What about all these anarchists?
We keep watch on them, and we know where to find them at any hour of the day.
Fisheries, sir.
Well, let us hope we'll have a quiet time in this Parliament.
We have reliable informers, sir. We feel that we know our London anarchists. There isn't really one of them with enough spunk to do anything.
Let's hope not. But you're not in Africa now.
I'm only out to earn an honest living.
Good evening, Professor. I hear you are seen constantly in places where men say foolish things over glasses of liquor.
You be damned.
Oh, here's another revolutionist.
Verloc, unusual to see you here.
Where's Michaelis?
Writing a book. A publisher has offered him £500. Of course, it'll be a ghastly failure. He spent so long in jail, he can't think logically anymore.
You plan the future. You lose yourself in dreams. The future will take care of itself. If only you make room for it.
What do you believe in?
Nothing. What about you?
Another drink.
Is he a member of your Red Committee?
A man more useful than important. He receives comrades from abroad. Hasn't any ideas of his own. An intellectual non-entity. The only talent he has shown is an ability to elude the attentions of the police.
That's a useful talent.
Are you worried that they'll arrest you?
There's not one of them with enough courage to do that. There is a detonator in this. If I press this ball, that's the principle of the pneumatic shutter. The detonator is partly mechanical, partly chemical.
20 seconds from the moment I press the ball until the explosion takes place. Nobody in this room will escape.
We've got to have a clean sweep before we can have a new life.
Get rid of all the old traditions and morality. Nothing would give me greater pleasure than to see Heat and his like shooting us down in broad daylight with the approval of the public.
So it should be. What is your plan?
I have no plan.
The secret agent, who was so important that he only appeared as a Greek letter in the correspondence of my predecessor, doesn't have a plan. What is more, he has the nerve to appear before me, looking like a master plumber about to present his bill.
I came here only to report difficulties.
The business of an agent provocateur
is to provoke. Yes. But it is necessary to find the right human material capable of achieving the aim of such an outrage without consequences. And such people are very hard to find.
It's my belief that you have been taking money from us on a regular basis in order to grow fat at the expense of the imperial government without providing the services for which you were supposedly so very valuable and secret. An explosion.
A bomb.
And sooner rather than later. It isn't necessary to spill a great deal of blood, but it must be sufficiently startling, ferociously imbecilic. Any bomb outrage must go beyond mere terrorism or vengeance. It must be pure. Purely destructive. So what? Art. Bomb in the National Gallery. There would be some screaming, of course, from artists and art critics and people of no account. But science, learning, any imbecile with an income believes in that.
Blow up the Greenwich Observatory. The English will go mad with fury. They'll start tearing the fingernails out of these political criminals. We'll even give them lessons, and the world, my dear Verloc, we'll be a safer place.
Now, the Conference of Milan ends in 1 month. A dynamite outrage must be provoked by then. If you fail, I will make sure your comrades know that you're a police informer as well as a respectable little bourgeois. And no doubt they will kill you.
German officer!
Give me that knife, Stevie.
He tore off a soldier's ear and they would not even punish him for it.
Give that knife to me. Give that knife. Give it to me!
Give it here, boy.
Mr. Verloc's a good man.
Yes, Stevie. Mr. Verloc's a very good man.
Helps poor people. Poor soldiers. Swine.
I'm taking this off you now, Stevie. Stevie. What's the point of printing things like this? We're not German slaves now, you know.
You're right.
None of our business.
Easy. It's all right, Stevie. It's all right.
That boy worships you, you know. He'd do anything for you.
Wait a moment.
Not too long.
It's Verloc.
A violent action.
I do not take my cue from the Red Committee. I am alone, and I will remain so. You should all be hung. No, Verloc.
You will help me in another way? In the matter of supply?
Oh, yes. I'll give the stuff to any fool who comes along. At a price.
And advice? To perpetrate an outrage?
A big bang.
An explosion against the building.
And who's going to carry out this attack? Not you, Verloc, surely. How are you going to go about it?
A delayed action fuse. So I can get away in good time. I don't know. Say perhaps 15 minutes. And of course the bomb must be disguised in some way.
Where's the building? You won't say.
It's a large public building in a park.
Do you want to place it inside or outside?
Outside. And it must be placed against the wall. And of course the device must not attract attention.
You must know exactly how the timing works. Plan everything down to the last detail. Anything unexpected would be dangerous. It doesn't take much time to pack a box with explosives, but you want a timing device so that you can get away. This is where the genius comes in. A combination of time and shock device has to be set up perfectly.
Is it dangerous?
Not if you don't panic.
When can I have it?
A week.
Stevie!
Stevie!
all those circles and patterns you were drawing. Here, sit down here. I'm gonna get you a glass of milk. It's a letter for you.
Anybody home?
Come on, Stevie. Go upstairs and have a rest.
Hello, Stevie. Here.
Stevie, go upstairs.
Times editorial is scathing about the bill to bring the fisheries into public ownership.
Oh, dear. Hmm. The secret agent, whose name was so secret that he was designated a Greek letter of the alphabet in the correspondence of my predecessor, Baron Stott-Turtenheim, has not done what he was told to do.
Is it a question of time, planning?
Time is fast running out for Mr. Verloc. The Milan Conference on Terrorism has begun. We may have to dispense with his services. All we need to do is to make sure that one of his anarchist friends finds out he's a police informer.
Would they kill him?
Mm, of course.
He was very useful to us in the past.
In the past, exactly.
It is planned! It will be done!
We'll give you 1 week.
Oh, Stevie's gone missing again. He went to the greengrocer's 2 hours ago. I've been everywhere.
Well, he won't go far.
He's been funny again, Adolf.
Mr. Verloc?
It's all right. He's there.
Where have you been? Where have you been?
I recognised him. He's been in the bookshop for hours. He couldn't remember the name of your street.
Did you go to the greengrocer's? Oh, he's been looking at those books again. Curse the day they taught you to read. Go inside. That's a strong word with you later. Thank you. Come inside, Stevie. Stevie, come inside.
It's all right. Hey. Now then, young man. What's all this about, huh? It's all right. It's all right. You're home now. You're home.
I see you wearing Mr. Verloc's overcoat yesterday.
No, Wynne.
I did, Stevie. You were hurrying to the greengrocer's.
Sorry, Winnie. It's a mistake.
Watch out for your mistakes. I better do both. Have you got your pocket money?
Hmm.
You've been all the day, Billy boy. Billy boy. Well?
There's nothing. It's as quiet as the grave.
Nothing's as quiet as that. Any foreign visitors?
There's nothing.
Perhaps your other employer knows more than I do.
Don't worry.
What about Michaelis? He's only out of jail on ticket of leave. And I want him back there.
Why? All he wants to do is write books.
Are you all right?
table for sitting room, please.
That's Tom's place, isn't it?
Thank you.
My dear Henry.
Thank you for your note.
There seems to be something of a hornet's nest over this soiree of mine.
Anna's been in touch with you, has she?
Oh, yes, she has. I am very fond of Annie, but she's always been a difficult girl. One thing in my favor is, she seems to listen to me.
She's very fond of you.
And I believe she has made a very good marriage. I think it's important that you invite your cousins to my soiree, in spite of Annie's feelings, if only for the sake of good family relations. I would be delighted to meet them.
I'm very grateful. What are you reading?
It's a manuscript. The autobiography of a prisoner by that ticket of leave man you met.
Friend Michaelis, is it?
It is very fine.
I'd like to read it.
Do you not think, dear reader, that if I had not been the optimist I am, I could not have found in 15 years some means to cut my throat? And, in the last instance, there were always the walls of my cell to dash my head against. I think if he went back to prison again, he would die. And I would never forgive you, Henry, if he did.
The violence that appears to be part of the development of civilization does not speed up man's progress, but rather acts as a brake upon it. Violence is not a catalyst, but a diversion.
No need to feel hopeless. People can fight injustice.
Kill the bad men?
No, it's not necessary to do that.
But they're bad.
Well, then, you have to show the world. You have to let people see that for themselves.
How? How, Mr. Verloc? Tell me.
Want to help poor people?
Yes, I do. Yes.
Oh, that's good.
Am I good?
Yes.
Am I?
Yes.
Stevie still gets very excited when any of your friends have been here talking.
Well, some of them are foolish. Tom Ossipon's all right, though. Perhaps he might profit from being sent out of town for a while.
Out of town?
Well, perhaps you couldn't get on without him.
I shouldn't get on without him. The idea.
It was just a thought.
Of course I can get on without him. There's nowhere for him to go, though, is there?
Michaelis? You wouldn't mind giving the boy a room? No visitors there, so no talk.
Hmm. He's very good to the boy. Does he really like him?
Sure, he likes him.
He's a good boy.
I could take him to sitting room myself, if you like. Make sure he's all right. If he doesn't get on, I'll fetch him back.
Now mind you don't get your clothes dirty in the country, Stevie. Oh, goodness me. Look at me like that. You know how you like to get yourself untidy, given half the chance. You haven't been away for such a long time before, have you?
Hey, Winnie, take your cab back. I'll be home this evening.
Bye-bye.
Great time,
Early? Going for one of your walks? You haven't had any breakfast. You can't go out on an empty stomach.
You're safe until you screw the top of it tight. Then you have enough time to get away. Do what you like with it till then. But don't let it fall heavily. Are you taking anyone with you?
No.
Your paper, Henry. Now, don't forget, we are with Margaret tonight.
How could I forget?
And you're not going to your club to play cards, I hope.
I'll be back by 6, I promise.
My super pretty! Michaelis?
Yes?
I'm taking this young fellow home for a day or two.
Oh. Very well. Goodbye, Stevie. I'll see you soon.
Oh, yes.
At home, haven't we?
Yes, dear.
Shh.
Stevie. Stevie! Stay with me.
Can't see your hand in front of your face. Roll me off my bike.
It's a bit clearer around there.
Each London anarchist exactly accounted for, is that right?
Yes.
And you think there were two men?
Eyewitness confirmed. One probably escaped the park under cover of the fog. The two men came from Sittingbourne. Two respectable working men of a superior sort. Sign painters or decorators. Carrying a bright tin can.
They don't sound very likely, do they?
Strips and bits of bright tin were found. There are only three got off at Greenwich. The other was a hawker from Gravesend, well known to the porter.
So, two foreign anarchists coming from Sittingbourne. Sounds unaccountable to me.
It would be unaccountable if Michaelis wasn't staying in a cottage in the neighbourhood.
Michaelis?
We have enough to go on. There'll be no difficulty getting up sufficient evidence against him. You may trust me for that, sir.
What can you bring up against him? Of a definite nature. Apart from the fact of two men coming from a village some 3 miles away from where Michaelis happens to be living now.
That's enough. Given the nature of the man we're dealing with. He murdered a policeman.
Not, I believe, personally, and I think when he was not much more than a youth. Did he report to the police before leaving London?
Yes, sir, he did.
And do we know what he's been up to while he's been down there? Writing a book. Do you think he was necessarily involved in the manufacture of the bomb?
I wouldn't say necessarily. He associates with men who are classed as dangerous. He was made a delegate of the Red Committee less than a year after his release.
And you think the investigation should go in that direction?
I do, sir.
You haven't heard the news?
No.
Wonderful that you, of all people, should have heard nothing. There's a man blown up in Greenwich Park today.
How do you know?
Oh, there's been yelling the news in the street since 2. I bought a paper. Not much so far. Bomb in Greenwich Park. Effects of the explosion felt as far away as Romney Road and Park Place. Enormous hole under a tree filled with smashed tree roots, broken branches. All around, fragments of a man's body blown to pieces. No doubt a wicked attempt to blow up the observatory, they say. The implication blew himself up. I had no idea that anything of this sort was being planned here.
Oh, you know about everything, do you?
Under the circumstances, this is nothing short of criminal.
Criminal?
Yes.
What is that? What is crime?
Oh, we must use the current terms. Look, this business may affect our position in this country very adversely. You're behind this. So you're just handing this stuff out to the first fool that comes along, eh?
Yes, sir. I make it a general rule never to refuse anyone.
Society was not built on paper and ink, and paper and ink will not put an end to it. My difficulty consists in experimenting practically.
Can you describe the person you gave this stuff to?
Oh, I don't think there can be the slightest objection now. I'll describe him to you in one word. Verloc.
Verloc.
You can't say I gave it to the first fool who came along. He either ran the time too close or let the thing fall.
We must disclaim all connection with this business.
Why don't you ask the police for a testimonial of good conduct? They know where you all slept last night. They might even put out some kind of statement.
No, no, no. They must know that we had nothing to do with this.
What will they say?
I'll get Michaelis to speak at one of our meetings. He'll talk bosh, but it will go down all right.
Like treacle. I'll give you a piece of advice. Fasten yourself on the wife for all you're worth.
That thing he was carrying must have gone off right against his chest.
Took it away without anybody noticing. It can always be produced if required.
Extraordinary thing. And what is 32 Brett Street?
Shop, sir.
What sort of shop?
It's a back street pornographer's in Soho. It's owned by someone I'm acquainted with.
Really?
Please inform us, sir.
Well? His name, Heat?
Name of Verloc.
Verloc. Anybody else know about him but you?
No, sir. He could never be produced publicly. It was sufficient for me to know who he was and to use him to good purpose.
This is the secret agent, the one you've got a hold over, is it?
Yes. His shop's left alone by the police. A word from us to the customs house people, and one of those packages from Brussels would be rummaged open in Dover.
Precarious trade. Why that?
He's a lazy dog.
He's a spy in the pay of a foreign government.
When it comes to my own work, I deal with the devil himself. There are things not fit for everybody to know.
Me, it seems. Well, how do you account for this?
I don't account for it. It needs looking into.
Oh, come now, Chief Inspector. Surely this tells us that it's your secret agent who's the man responsible for this outrage. And that he's paid the price.
No, sir. It is not in his character.
Well, what other explanation can there be?
I think the man who had most to do with it will turn out to be Michaelis.
Do you?
He visits that address.
Very well, we will talk further tomorrow. In the meantime, I think you'd better leave this with me.
Thank you, sir.
One can be positive about anything, sir. I can assure you that it is not.
Your assurances seem to consist of making the Secretary of State look a fool. I have been promised positively in this room that no such thing was even possible.
That information came from Chief Inspector Heat, sir.
Heat, yes. You're still rather a novice in your new berth.
Sir, this does not seem to be the usual anarchist outrage. Not when one looks into it deeply. Sufficient to say that evidence at the scene of the explosion points to an address in London where a police informer resides. Now, this police informer, who's known as Verloc, was also, I'm afraid, in the pay of a foreign government and was recruited into the service of that government by the then Imperial Ambassador himself.
No. What do they mean by introducing their Crimean methods here? I mean, a Turk would have more decency.
We have no positive proof, sir.
Yes, well, I would like to know what you intend to do.
I believe this to be a peculiarly stupid and feeble affair, and I have excellent hopes to get to the bottom of it. But I think it should be handled with discretion. Now, it's possible that this man Verloc has destroyed himself by an accident, and that by an accident of fate, we have found his address on the clothing. But instead of instructing Chief Inspector Heat to continue with the case, it's my intention to discover the explanation personally. At the shop in Brett Street.
Goodness gracious, look at you. You're soaked right through. Well, I'll help you off with that. I'll have you laid up.
I don't think so.
Where have you been today?
Nowhere. I've been to the bank.
Have you? What did you go there for?
To draw the money out.
What do you mean, all of it?
Yes, all of it.
What did you do that for?
We may want it soon.
Don't know what you mean.
You know I can be trusted.
If I hadn't trusted you, I wouldn't have married you.
Oh, my... Stevie! Stevie, no! Oh, my God, my God. My God, my God. What?
Sergeant?
Sir?
Has Chief Inspector Heat been in here?
Yes, sir.
Is he still in the building?
No, sir. He left about half an hour ago.
I see. Thank you.
Neatly, London. Get away. France, perhaps.
You've just been to France.
No, emigrate. Canada's a possibility. I've drawn the money out.
Emigrate?
I've had enough of London.
The idea!
I'm so sick of this, sick and tired of everything. I'm just too much.
You've had a bad cold.
No.
Yes, you have.
I have to go. No choice.
You've a comfortable home. And you're not tired of me. Hmm?
Business isn't so bad. Well, what would Stevie do? Have you thought about that? We couldn't take him abroad. What would people think of him there? They might not be so kind in France. No, it wouldn't do at all, Adolf. It wouldn't do at all. Had you considered Stevie when you thought of this plan? Well, if you do go abroad, you might have to go without me. You would. You'd have to go without me. You couldn't. You'd miss me too much. Sure, you go, Adolf. I've got my apron on.
I've been looking for Mr. Verloc.
I am Mr. Verloc.
Mr. Verloc. We thought you might be dead.
You
do understand English, don't you?
Yes, I understand English. Your husband hasn't slipped out the back way by any chance, has he?
Do you know that man?
I've heard of him.
Is he one of Yunt's friends? That beastly old man, is
no,
he?
No, no, no.
Well, whoever he is waiting for you.
Yes.
Is he one of your embassy friends you've been bothered with of late?
Who's been talking to you about embassy friends?
You've been talking in your sleep.
What did I say?
Mostly nonsense. You've been worried about something.
Yes. I've cut their hearts out one after another.
Give me the money. You got it in your pocket. I don't trust him. Get rid of him as soon as you can. And you come home to me.
Yes.
You need looking after for a couple of days.
How nice to see you.
My dear lady.
You've heard about the atrocity in Greenwich.
Here in England, I thought I was dreaming and had woken up back at home. But you have the best police force in the world. They'll get to the bottom of it.
Excuse me. I have some people I want to introduce to you. New relations of Annie's. Henry's cousins, Major and Mrs. Anderson. Vladimir Pienskov.
Good evening.
I'd like a room, please.
Ah, Signor Belloc. Five pence. Top of the stairs.
Husband at home, Mrs. Belloc?
No, he's gone out.
I'm sorry for that. I've called for a little piece of information.
He'll be back soon.
The information I need is quite private. I wonder if you could give me a notion of where he's gone to.
I can't.
You know I'm a policeman.
I don't trouble my head about it.
My name is Chief Inspector Heat of the Special Crime Section. So, your husband didn't say when he'd be back?
No.
Was he on his own?
No.
A friend?
A stranger. A gentleman.
Oh. What sort of gentleman?
He's tall, blue eyes, very confident.
I know that you're at the bottom of this affair. Who put you up to it?
Got a tongue. They had it coming to them.
Who?
I was never involved in anything like this. In Stott Wartenheim's time.
Baron Stott Wartenheim? The former ambassador from their imperial majesties.
Scores of these revolutionaries I've sent off with bombs in their pockets to get caught at the frontier at the risk of my life. A venomous beast driving me into a ditch to starve.
Who?
The embassy lot. Vladimir. The old baron would never have called me to the embassy during the day. There are two or three people I know. If they'd seen me go in.
They'd what? They'd kill you? Are you telling me that the first secretary at the Imperial Embassy told you to bomb Greenwich Observatory?
The old baron knew what I was worth to his country.
And this Mr. Vladimir threatened to dispense with your services if you didn't do this?
Yes. And expose me as a police informer. Here, and that made it very difficult for him to crack down on them in his own country. So he wanted an act of provocation. He wanted to shock them all at the Milan conference. He knew it all. I should have taken that brute by the throat and rammed his head against the fireplace.
It might have saved us all some trouble if you had.
I wanted to speak to your husband about,
Stolen overcoat.
We haven't lost an overcoat.
Well, that's strange. You keep a lot of marking in here. See, the overcoat, has a label sewn on the inside with your address written in marking ink.
It must be my brother's.
Ah.
He could run. I thought he'd get clear away. But the fog was so thick he couldn't see.
Who was he?
My wife's brother. He was simple.
Where's your brother? Can I see him?
He's staying in the country with a friend.
What's the name of the friend?
A Mr. Michaelis.
I thought the worst was that he might get caught in the act.
He was simple, you see?
Well, he was all right. He was just feeble.
And how did you hope to escape detection if he was caught?
He wouldn't have said anything.
What were you doing buying tickets from Sittingbourne? Did Michaelis have anything to do with this?
No, he knew nothing about it. The boy was staying with him. I just didn't want my wife to know what we were up to, that's all.
So you fetched him from there and you were going to take him back, right?
Yes.
Michaelis didn't put you up to it.
No.
you going to do with me?
I'm going to let you go home. You must talk to your wife.
Well, I've looked after him since he was a baby. He's a bit absent-minded.
That's why this address is written in his overcoat.
How did he come to lose his coat?
I suppose you recognize this.
Why is it burnt like this?
Like a word or two. I won't arrest you. He recognizes this for himself. But don't forget, I found you out. I feel about this twin is lip. You must have been mad.
Well, I have been mad. For over a month.
If I were you, I'd clear out.
Oh, yeah.
We won't run after you.
No. You hope somebody else will get rid of me. You can't shake me off as easily as that. No, I've been straight, but it'll all come out now.
Perhaps you'd tell me how you got away.
After the bang. Started running. Lost my direction. I was making for just a few war footers.
Easy as that. The bang startled you, eh?
Yes. Came too soon.
We believe he stumbled. Blown to small bits. Things. Rebel. Clothing. All mixed up together. Had to fetch a shovel to get them out. I wouldn't trust the gentleman you've been talking to. You may get let in for a sentence that will surprise you. You take my advice. You clear out. There are some of them who think you're out of the world already.
Indeed.
Oh, God.
Clear out. Vanish.
Where to?
I wish you'd take me away tonight.
I dare say.
Yes, but he's so late. What am I to do with myself? You'll please me very much by keeping Henry's cousins entertained.
Well? Something?
Rather, the police inform a Verloc is alive. The victim was, in fact, his brother-in-law.
And you were right to suspect,
Oh, Verloc's indignation leaves me in no doubt whatsoever that the first secretary of the Imperial Embassy drove him near out of his mind.
Well, how do you mean?
Why, an extraordinary performance. You and I might not have taken it seriously, sir, but Verloc did. They bullied and threatened him to undertake an act of provocation which they thought would force us into some repressive measures. Verloc thought they'd give him away and he'd be killed by his anarchist friends.
So, what have you done with him?
Well, since the fellow is anxious to see his wife, sir, I let him go.
You'll disappear?
I don't think so, sir. It would be too suspicious to his friends, and besides, at the moment, I don't think he has the moral resolution to do a thing.
Winnie? Winnie, you can't stay in the shop like this. Someone could come in at any moment. This won't bring him back. Be reasonable, Winnie. What if you lost me?
Wait. Winnie, please, don't be a fool.
If you only knew what a brute I had to deal with. What was the point of telling you that I stood the risk of having a knife stuck in my back at any time these 10 years? Winnie, I'm not the sort of man to worry his wife. Me into a ditch to stop. I could tell he thought it was a joke. With some of the highest in the world have me to thank for standing on their two legs to this very day. And this swine comes along. This ignorant, overbearing swine. Winnie, if it hadn't been for you, I'd have been more than a match for that pink-faced smooth shave. I would have taken it by the throat. Don't think he would have called the police. Well, you know why, don't you? Don't you?
I don't know what you're talking about.
You've got to get a grip, my girl. What's done can't be undone. Winnie, you must pull yourself together. Once I'm under lock and key, it'll be easier for me to talk. But I might be away for 2 years. Of course, it'll be easier for you than me. You must keep this business going, Winnie. But that's all right. You've got a good business head about you. But you've got to be careful. You've got to keep as close as the grave. The comrades will be watching you. I don't want a knife in my back as soon as I get out. I don't want one of them to get rid of me. Well, I'm too fond of you for that, Winnie. When I get out of prison, we'll go abroad. We'll lie low for a bit.
Where are you going? Upstairs? Oh, good, Winnie. That's right. That's what you need. Rest and quiet.
You go on, Winnie. It won't be long before I'm with you.
I must say now that it's against my principles to countenance the idea of bombers running wild and free.
Well, there you have it.
Michaelis is behind this.
I'm afraid not. As for bombers running wild and free, I think I can say it'll be no repetition. And if I'm wrong, and I can assure you that I'm not, then it is I and not you who will take the blame for it. In short, there'll be no arrests. And you will say nothing. Now, if you'll excuse me, Chief Inspector, I have an engagement.
I'd almost given you up, Henry.
I'm sorry.
Did you find out who was responsible?
I'm glad to tell you that Michaelis is altogether clear of this.
Were your people stupid enough to connect him? You know he's non-violent.
Hatred of the middle classes, with murder and mayhem as their goal. Picture it, picture it.
Mr. Vladimir has been frightening me, Henry.
You don't look frightened.
Well, he's tried, at least.
Force of habit.
He's been promising all kinds of horrors. It appears we all ought to quake in our shoes if the people who are responsible for this explosion aren't suppressed. I had no idea it was so serious.
I'm sure Mr. Vladimir knows just how serious it is. Would you excuse us for just a moment, my dear? Arrested a man called Verloc.
I beg your pardon?
You know him.
What makes you say that?
Verloc says so. You know, Mr. Vladimir, there's one thing that pleases me about this affair. It gives me the opportunity to clear out a whole lot of foreign political spies. What a ghastly nuisance. And now, do you see, the prosecution of Verloc will demonstrate their danger to the public.
Nobody would believe a pornographer.
Oh, you do know him, then? What they will believe is the wealth of precision and detail.
So this is what you mean to do? Seriously?
We've got the man. We have no choice.
You're feeding up the lying spirit of these animals. Why? Why, some sense of morality?
No, there is a practical side. You can't complain about the inefficiency of our police. In 12 hours, we've identified a man blown to shreds. We found the bomber, and we've caught a glimpse of the provocateur behind him. We could, of course, have gone further, but we stopped at the limit of our territory.
So it was planned abroad?
In the diplomatic sense. But that, of course, is a fiction.
I really don't understand you people. We have greater experience of these revolutionaries. We suffer greatly from their activities, while you suffer their presence gladly in your midst, which makes us suffer even more.
Well, your government grumbled most about our police. I just wanted to tell you about one of our successes.
I'm sure I'm very grateful.
This is the sort of news that can wait, Winnie. Winnie!
Your mother will be in bed long before you get there.
Your place is here this evening. Take that hat off. Please. I can't let you go out, old girl. Can't you say something? I know this deaf and dumb trick of yours. Take that hat off! I can't tell when I'm talking to a live woman or a dummy!
Winnie, I hunted high and low for somebody to do that job. I even ran the risk of giving myself away, but I couldn't find anybody hungry enough or crazy enough.
What do you think I am? A murderer? Do you think I wanted him to blow himself up?
Winnie, he's gone forever. His troubles are over. Ours are just... Winnie, it was an accident, a pure accident, just as if he'd been run over by a bus in the street. And it was as much your fault as mine. I never thought of the lad for that. Only you kept shoving him in my way, and I was half distracted with worry about how to keep us both out of trouble. Why the devil did you do that, Winnie? Why? Tell me why! You have such a devilish way of holding your tongue at times. It's enough to drive some men mad. It's lucky I'm not so easily put up. Winnie, I'm very fond of you, but please don't go too far, please. Now is not the time. Now is the time we've got to be thinking about what we're going to do. Together.
I wish to goodness I'd never set eyes on Greenwich Park.
Mrs. Verloc! Where are you going?
Don't ask. What would you say if I was to tell you that I was looking for you?
I'd say You couldn't find anyone more ready to help you.
You know them?
Of course. As soon as I read the evening paper, I had to come. I've been fond of you beyond words. I couldn't conceive it, but you always seem so distant.
What do you expect? I was a married woman. I was a respectable woman until he made me what I am.
You were worthy of something better.
He cheated me 7 years.
But you always seemed so happy. That's why I was so timid. I was surprised and jealous. You seemed to love him.
You thought I loved him. I was a good wife. I was a respectable woman. There was a young man once. He went away. Cheers. You know what he was? That friend of yours? He was the devil.
He's dead now.
You know what I had to do then?
Well, how did you first come to hear of it?
The chief inspector came. Heat. The chief inspector Heat. He showed me. No, they had to gather him up with a shovel.
Do you mean the police have been here already?
Yes.
Heat came to tell you himself.
Yes. He showed me a piece of his overcoat.
What did he do?
Nothing. He went away, and then another man came.
Another inspector came?
Yes. He might have been. He might have been from the embassy.
What embassy? Embassy?
I don't know.
This other fellow. What did he say to you?
I can't remember. I don't know. I'll leave me alone. Hide me.
I can't take you where I live. I share it with a friend.
You must. Somewhere. I thought you cared for me.
It may be possible, perhaps, to find a safe lodging somewhere, but I have only a few pence.
I've got money.
How much have you got?
All of it. I've got all of it. He gave me all of the money. They mustn't find me. If they do, you must kill me. Promise me you'll kill me first, Tom.
It's all right. Don't worry. There's a boat train at midnight to San Marino. What is it?
The shop door is open.
Leave it! What does it matter? Look.
The light's still on in the parlor. Go and
put it out. Where's all the money?
It's on me. Go and put the light out. I won't be hanged, Tom. I'll work for you. I'll slave for you. I love you. I won't ask you to marry me. He took that harmless boy out to be killed. That loving, harmless lad. My own. Come here, he said, after telling me I'd helped to kill him. Come here, like that.
breaking my heart to smash in the mud. Come here. What do you think I was made of? Tell me! Save me! Save me, Tom. I won't leave you.
Get up. Get up. Let's get out of here. We lose the train. You go first. Go. See that the way is clear.
Station, you go ahead of me. We don't know each other. Go straight to the ladies' first-class waiting room and stay there till 5 minutes before the train. You'd better give me that money now. Do you know how much is here?
I don't know.
In his own name.
Why?
Because the notes are numbered. It's extremely important.
He has an account in the name of Prozor.
You are sure? You are sure?
I'm certain.
I told him not to let anyone else into our compartment.
You'll get me off, Tom.
Don't worry. He was remarkable, that brother of yours.
He was. You were kind to him, Tom. I loved you for that.
It is remarkable how alike you are.
I wanted to die when he was taken away from me.
It's all right. Come. Sit here. Away from the platform.
see Mr. Vladimir's been recalled. He was rather a witty man.
He didn't know a thing about Furlock's death.
He doesn't read the newspapers. They make him too sad.
He lives on a diet of carrots and milk.
How does she look on it?
Angelic. His poverty of reasoning is astonishing. He's elaborating now on the world planned as an immense hospital, with gardens and flowers in which the strong are to devote themselves to nursing the weak. He has no logic.
Anarchism was created by the laws which capitalism made to protect private property. History is determined by economic conditions, and the ideas that float around in the consciousness of man play only a tiny, insignificant part. There is an inevitability about history which will lead mankind ever nearer to a better future. First slavery, then feudalism, then individualism, then capitalism, and finally.
Ha ha ha.